Good evening, coming to you from an undisclosed location in Michigan. This is the Vladcast program, and I'm your host, John Hill. I'm here with my guest, Father Gregory Joyce, rector of St. Vladimir Parish in Ann Arbor, Dexter something.
Yeah.
Yes, Father, good to have you on the Vladcast program.
Thank you, John.
How have you been?
Thank God, no complaints. It's been a really great time since we had our last Vladcast, and I'm excited to let the viewers know that we've set up a schedule between Josh, who you can't see behind the camera, and John and I, so that we'll be filming more regularly. So that's good, I think, for all of us, that we have some structure, and we'll be able to put out the Vladcast more regularly.
Glory to God.
Yes, I'm really glad about that.
They tried to kill the Vladcast by benign neglect, but we wouldn't let them.
That's right.
Once we got our act together.
Exactly.
And here we are.
That's right.
And it is now almost Cross Sunday, yes?
Yes, we're almost to the midway point of Great Lent.
So I reckon we can talk about some Lent, and then what follows Lent, which is another fast. And then we'll see where we get, I'm not sure I remember where we go from there, but I'm sure you'll tell us.
We'll work on it together.
Let's start with Cross Week and what that means and what we do.
Good. Yeah, that's a great place to start. What we should mention, we're gonna, by the time this is posted, people may not, the funeral may have already happened, but we had one of our parish family passed away on the 15th of March, Stephen Lohman, so we want to ask everybody's prayers for Stephen during these 40 days, and his 40th day actually ends up being Thomas Sunday, when we always go to the graves, so it works out quite nicely.
Okay.
So Cross Sunday is coming up. It's the midway point of Great Lent, and it's really hard for people to believe. The reason that it's the midway point, if you're now running to your calendars and looking and counting and saying, wait a second, there's a problem here, because, Holy Week is not Great Lent, and Great Lent is not Holy Week, and so this is the middle point of Great Lent. And it's not a mistake that the cross is brought out. It's both for the sort of strengthening and joy of the faithful, but also as a reminder of where we're going in this Great Lent. You know, where are we heading? And we are heading, of course, towards Holy Week and the cross and to be with the Lord then. So this is a comfort and a strengthening for the faithful, but also a reminder that we are not just fasting for the sake of fasting, but we are preparing ourselves for something greater than that. So
now, is this Cross Sunday, did it replace something that was there before, like Saint Polycarp or something?
No, I don't think so. The first two were replacing something, so it was not until the 9th century, probably, or the very end of the 8th century, probably the 9th century, when Sunday of Orthodoxy began to be celebrated, and that was replacing the Apostles. And then the second Sunday of Great Lent, which is St. Gregory of Palamas, well, he lived in the 14th century, so obviously they did something until then. That was St. Polycarp. But the cross seems to have been part of this structure of Great Lent as we know it, ever since we knew it. So, and you know, it's interesting. I was thinking about this the other day, and I don't know the answer to the question that is the next logical one, so I'll ask it.
Now, why would you think that I would ask the logical question?
Well, I'm just making, maybe I shouldn't assume, but what were the Sundays that were celebrated for St. John of the Ladder and St. Mary of Egypt? Because they are earlier, right? They're earlier, pretty early in the Christian sort of life. And I don't know the answer to that. I'm gonna try to find that out. So in the next Vladcast, or maybe we'll put a little something on the blog that will explain what was celebrated on the fourth and fifth Sundays. But the third Sunday, the Sunday of the Cross, seems to have been there as long as this structure has been in place.
Excellent question, Father.
Thank you.
Yes. And how many other major fasting periods don't end with breaking the fast?
Don't end with breaking the fast, none that I'm aware of.
This is
the only one where a fast is followed by a fast. Oh. Yep, and that's something very interesting. Before we leave the cross, though, I should mention something that folks might not be ready for. There's a big feast that falls in the somewhere in Great Lent every year, the 40 Martyrs of Sebastia. Mm-hmm. You know, we bake the larks, the other breads.
Never, it always occurs during Lent?
Yes, this one can fall outside Lent. Hmm. And so it's always during Great Lent, and it's always a big feast. And so folks get used to that, and it's the 22nd of March. It's always the 22nd of March. Well, it is always the 22nd of March, except when it's not. And this year happens to be one of those years. It's rare, very rare.
Oh.
But because it's...
So it's a semi-movable feast.
Very semi-movable. It happens that this year, the Feast of the 40 Martyrs falls on the Wednesday after the cross. Because of the cross holiday, that cross holiday kind of carries all the way through that week. There are portions of the liturgical services that are filled by the cross holiday. And because it's the mid-Wednesday of Great Lent, there's actually not the opportunity to do such a high-ranking service there. So in the Typikon, it instructs that you move it to the day before. So even though the Feast of the Martyrs is the 22nd of March, this year it'll be celebrated on the 21st.
Tuesday.
Yes, Tuesday. So that'll be a big, big week for us, God willing, and we have the strength. We'll serve liturgy on Tuesday and Tuesday in the morning, Wednesday evening, and then Friday morning as well. So it's unusual. I don't actually even remember the last time that this happened, but it is possible, and the Typikon foresees that possibility and mandates that we move the feast a day early.
Wow.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we move on from the cross, and then we go to St. John of the Ladder.
Yeah, great Sunday, very interesting.
A.K.A. Climacus.
Yep.
Latin word.
Yep, good, but a good Latin word.
Mm-hmm.
Latin's a good language, we like
sure.
that. In fact, we even teach that in our seminary. This is a real interesting feast because, of course, St. John wrote this very famous book, The Ladder of Divine Ascent, which is a really good book to read. And in fact, in monasteries, it's usually read as part of the services of at least the first week. It could be read throughout the other weeks, but the first week of Great Lent, there are certain pauses in the service when the ladder is read.
It's a great icon too, by the way.
Absolutely.
Very interesting.
I love that icon.
Unusual.
Yeah, that's a really good one.
Climbing up the ladder.
Climbing up the ladder. It's a very beautiful one, so definitely don't miss church on that weekend. That's a really great book, and a lot of times people want to read that book during Great Lent, which is an excellent idea. But it is a book written for monastics, and so if you're not a monastic, it's important that you read that with I don't want to say a grain of salt, but with the understanding that not everything there is necessarily directly applicable to you as a non-monastic, and I'm more than happy to talk about that with you. So if you're reading that in our parish, and you read something there that doesn't seem like it's really possible to apply in your life, please talk to me about that, because it might not really be something that's for you. Now, generally, the book is awesome, and everyone should read it at least once. But I think it's good for us to remember, this book is written for monastics, and I'm not living in a monastic life, therefore, not everything here is necessarily applicable to me.
Right, the part about how often to wash your monk robes, maybe.
So those kind of things. And even sometimes the prayer rules or different things. But I think, in general, it's a very good book, and everybody should read it. One of my favorite, in fact, probably my favorite anecdote from the book, is there was a monk in his cell struggling to save his soul, and he looked up on the windowsill, and he saw there a demon. And the demon was sort of had his legs crossed and was just sort of, you know, looking down at him. And he said to the demon, the monk said to the demon, "You're so lazy." And he said, "You're doing all of my work for me. I'm just watching." Mm-hmm. So, very interesting sort of thing. You know, sometimes if we struggle without guidance, sometimes we can be struggling but actually not moving in the right direction. And that's the point of this anecdote, is that it's important to have some direction as we're in our Great Lenten struggle.
Yeah. And demons are not generally dumb.
No. Great psychologists understand human nature really wonderfully. I mean, unfortunately for us, but we, you know, we have to be wise as a serpent and harmless as a dove. And reading the book, The Ladder of Divine Ascent, can help us on that wise as a serpent part.
Where does that wise as a serpent come from? Is that from the scripture?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's a good one. I think it's a good one. And, you know...
Gospels?
I believe, yes.
Oh.
New Testament. I'll have to double check. But we, I don't want to.
Should we make a list of your homework?
I've got some homework already, and we just started. But yes, I can't give you chapter and verse, but New Testament.
All right, one more, if that's possible. Maybe you know this. What language was the letter written in originally? John of the letter. What did he write there? Or did he
guess Aramaic, but that may not be right. I would have to double check that. But it's quite ancient.
Yeah. And what monastery was he?
It was in St. Savas, I believe. And then he went out into the desert.
Farther. Okay.
Yeah, we'll have to check that. That's a really good question.
Yeah.
I've never had that question asked. But based on the place and the time, I would guess Aramaic. But we'll double check.
Okay.
Yeah, that's good. Excellent.
This was before. This was before the Muslim conquest of okay.
Yeah. It was. I believe St. John is from 6th century. I have to double check that. But yeah, it was old enough. I mean, it was only in the last 200 years when most villages who were speaking Aramaic ceased doing that. So it was, it was definitely spoken then.
Crazy. Okay. Then we have 5th Sunday.
Yeah, and this is a great week. The whole week is great. It's almost, I was talking to my wife about this today, it's almost like the first steps of Holy Week take place during the 5th week, because this is where we have this most unusual service, the Standing of St. Andrew, or sometimes people call it the Standing of St. Mary.
That's a Thursday.
It's a Thursday, but the big reading is done on Wednesday night, right? So at the Matin service. The liturgy is Thursday, but the big long service is Wednesday. It's a long service. It's probably the longest single service of the year. And that canon of St. Andrew of Crete that we read the first 4 days, broke up over the first 4 days of Great Lent, is read in its entirety. Plus the life of St. Mary. And it's really interesting because this is the only life of a saint which is mandated to be read in the church, according to the Typikon. Now, that's not a mistake. I mean, of all the lives of the saints, to have it be St. Mary, it means that this is a very important and edifying tale for us. So, it is a long service, but I think we shouldn't look at it like, oh, it's a long service, like this is a challenge. This is something special for us. The Lord is giving us a nice kind of opportunity to really struggle. Right. And yet it's so edifying to hear the canon of St. Andrew, the life of St. Mary. It's really a wonderful service. And, people look forward to it every year. I look forward to it every year. It is long, but it's long with a lot of beautiful content in it.
Well, it's different. There's really nothing like it.
Exactly.
And so if you pay, a little attention, time will go by.
Absolutely. This is one of those ones where it usually rolls out to about 4 hours. It can seem almost like the snap of a finger, because half the life of St. Mary is read kind of towards the middle, towards the beginning, half towards the middle, and by that point, you're so kind of wrapped up in the life. And then you have the canon of St. Andrew of Crete. Anyway, it's a really great service, and I really hope that a lot of people can participate. Yes, we will broadcast it. It's not the same. I mean, it's good. If you can't be there, turn on the broadcast, light a lamp, lower the lights, pray with us. That's the best way to utilize the live broadcast. But if you can, be with us, because it really is a beautiful and wonderful service.
All right, what is the date for that Wednesday?
I want to say the 30th. No, it's the very end. Let's see, 30th, I think the 30th of March. Anyway, it's the last Wednesday evening of March.
Okay.
The Wednesday of 5th week.
Okay. Then what about unction? Do we do unction still?
Yep, we have unction. We have general unction every Great Lent. Thank God. In the practice of the Russian Church, pre-revolutionary Russian Church, the bishops would take the opportunity of Great Lent to basically try to visit as many of their parishes as they could. And so they would go to the parish, and that evening they would serve unction. That would be kind of a big one, and a lot of the smaller ones from around
would be like a roadshow.
Yeah, the church sort of. Yes, of course. I took it in the best possible way.
Bring a deacon or two.
Exactly, absolutely. And it was a really big deal. And so this idea of general unction, where we are seeking healing of our souls during this time of Great Lenten struggle became very ingrained in the Russian practice. But because of that, where the bishop was kind of going around the diocese, it could happen any time. So we don't marry it to a certain day. In the Greek tradition, it's either Holy Thursday or Wednesday. I can't remember. One of those evenings,
Holy
it's always
Thursday.
I think
isn't there enough going on already? Holy
I'm
Thursday?
Almost sure it's Wednesday, but in any case, there is a day, a set day when it's always done. But in the Russian tradition, it was any day. And so for us, it's going to be April 4th. It's April 4th, and we invited all the priests from the deanery to come. And I
at
hope
St.
We'll
Vladimir.
At St. Vladimir
which
this
is
year.
Not always. What?
No, we rotate back and forth with the cathedral in Ferndale. But this year is our turn, and it'll be 6 o'clock. There's a lot of information on our website, explains to folks how to prepare themselves. Most important, confession is tied to unction, and so you'll want to have gone to confession relatively close to that date. Not the day before, not the day of, that's not what I'm saying, but not 6 weeks before either. You know, find a time when you have recently gone to confession and communion, and maybe you'll go to confession and communion on the weekend before, and then unction will be Tuesday. So.
And it's a vigil?
Well, it's its own standalone service, but it is a pretty long one. So it has a vigil.
So there's no is there a liturgy the next day?
No. Well, actually, there will be this year. But that'll be a Wednesday evening one. So that'll be where we start at 3 o'clock and do all the services until 6:30 in the evening and do pre-sanctified liturgy that day after. But it's not connected to the unction. But it does kind of work nicely that if you have the opportunity to go to confession, then to participate in the unction service, then to go to communion the next day, it would just be a very nice sort of set of sacraments that you get to participate in. And so this is our one chance a year, as long as we're healthy physically, thank God, to participate in unction. And we hope that everybody can come and participate.
So there's no makeup day if you missed out?
No makeup day, nope. It's the only one in this deanery. I'm sure there are, for instance, all of the Greek churches in Detroit will have it on that Holy Wednesday. But at St. Vladimir's or in the Russian churches in the Detroit area, or in Michigan actually, this is the one chance.
Okay. April 8th?
April 8th will be a Saturday. The 7th, okay. I think, is a Friday this year, Annunciation, or Thursday? I don't know. Let's see. The 8th is a Saturday, so it must be a Friday. Yeah, Annunciation must be a Friday.
Right after the unction.
Yeah, the unction is the 4th, and a few days later we have the Feast of the Annunciation. So it's a packed week.
That sounds familiar. Mm-hmm. Annunciation.
Yes.
Is that the fish day?
That is. And it is a fish day this year. Not always.
Wait.
Next year, get ready, it won't be.
Why?
Because it's going to be on Holy Saturday. So if Annunciation falls in that deep, for sure, in Holy Week, and it is often Holy Saturday, actually. If you observe over time the dates when Pascha falls, it's not uncommon for it to be April 8th, but it's almost never April 7th. Isn't that interesting? About every 100 years, it's April 7th. But it'll be next year will be April 8th, so the 7th will be Holy Saturday, and so no fish. But at that point, you know, we're almost home.
Right.
So it's not too bad. To me, the hardest years are when Annunciation is also Palm Sunday. Those are our two fish days.
Oh.
And it can happen.
And they
can coincide.
Uh-huh.
It doesn't happen too often, but it's not crazy unusual. So anyway, but you know, I shouldn't let my stomach run my spiritual life, but sometimes I fall to that. In any case, this year it falls outside of Holy Week, and therefore it is our fish day before Palm Sunday.
So besides fish, what is remarkable about Annunciation?
Well, Annunciation, being the sort of pretty important holiday that it is, it really falls nicely, I think, it wasn't my decision, this wasn't designed by me. The Lord decided that it would be this way. It falls during Great Lent, and when you're especially approaching Holy Week, and you're thinking about the Holy Land, and you're thinking about, you know, all of the things that are happening there, 33 years later from the time of this Annunciation. I don't know, I just kind of like it's almost like one bookend, and the second bookend is, you know, like Holy Friday, kind of, or Pascha. Mm-hmm. You know, so it to me, it's a really interesting, I don't want to say dichotomy, but I think bookend is the right way to think about it. Here is kind of the beginning.
The angel.
Yes, when Archangel Gabriel comes to speak to the Mother of God. And then you have, within a few days, we're sort of marking the end of the Lord's ministry. So it's, to me, I think it's just such a beautiful feast, and it's such a sort of, really marks such a nice beginning. So I really, it's one of my favorite feasts. I like it very, very much, and I think that a lot of people also do. And yes, it's true, we can eat fish during the feast, and that's nice. But it's just such a beautiful and meaningful feast. And especially, you know, this interaction that the Archangel Gabriel and the Mother of God had. It's not like he said, you know, you're it and that's it and you're done. This is a conversation. She could have just as easily said, you know what, that just doesn't really fit my schedule. Like, I got other things to do. You know, sorry, I'll pass. And it just seems to me that as she voluntarily takes upon herself this cross, you know, her son also voluntarily takes the cross on himself. So I don't want to make too much out of like the literary or, you know, connections. But I like that. I think that it's really a nice time for us to reflect, you know, to think about the decisions that we make in our life.
Now, how do we know that it was that she had the choice? What's the evidence in the scripture or the tradition or what?
Yeah, it's so there.
What gives that idea?
It's where she says, "Be it unto thy handmaiden." You know, let me think if I can get the exact quote. But basically, they're talking back and forth, and she's saying, "Well, that's, you know, like, I'm not married. How is this going to happen?" I'm paraphrasing, obviously. And he explains the situation, and she says, again, paraphrasing, "Yes, I agree. Be it unto me according as thou sayest," or something like that. And so here she voluntarily says, "Yeah, I'll do that." It wasn't this kind of thing where she was forced into it. And that's really important for us as Orthodox Christians. We stress so often free will and the choices that we make and the repercussions that they have. Mm-hmm. And it's nice to see this free will being used also for something, you know, good or something that's greater than oneself. Because really, if you think about the Mother of God, her ministry was so much greater than just as it had to do with herself and her son also, of course. His ministry was so much greater than just himself going onto the cross. So I just think it's a really nice time of year to think about the decisions that we make and not to be quite so narcissistic as the society sometimes invites us to be. You know, to think outside of ourselves and the way that the decisions we make in our lives affect others. So, yeah, beautiful time. Beautiful time with Annunciation.
All right, that's... What did we say? Friday?
Yep.
The liturgy's on Friday.
Yep, that's right.
Vigils
will be Thursday. Yep.
Mm-hmm. And then that gets us to the Ladder, St. John of the Ladder Sunday.
No. This is the next day after that.
Palm Sunday.
Palm Sunday. Lazarus. So yeah, we've left Great Lent.
We leave it on Friday.
Yeah, I mean the Friday evening service, the Matins for Lazarus. That's the first service of Holy Week.
All right, then Holy Week.
Yeah,
we have time to discuss Holy Week.
At least we can get on, hit the highlights.
Okay.
Lazarus, very interesting culinary fast on that day. You can eat eggs.
Stomach again.
Yeah, stomach.
Oh, you can eat eggs.
You can eat eggs. Fish eggs. Isn't it interesting?
No, about pheasant eggs?
Fish eggs. They have to swim in the water. Yeah, not ducks.
Okay.
No. Interesting. You know, eggs are this symbol of the resurrection that, and here is a small resurrection, a foretelling, a foreshadowing of Christ's resurrection. And so eggs are allowed, but it's still a Lenten period. So
now, is that a Russian thing or do all the Orthodox?
No. Yeah, all the Orthodox do that. That's actually something that's in the Typikon. Isn't that interesting? I find that very interesting. That sort of reflection of the divine service, which is preparing us for the resurrection and is a foreshadowing of the resurrection of Christ, also has this sort of culinary little piece, which
it's a spiritual thing that's also a material
exactly
thing,
just like us,
which what we're supposed to think
exactly
about.
Exactly. And of course Lazarus and Palm Sunday is one big feast. It's two separate days, but I mean even a lot of the hymns are the same. The Troparia or the feast are sung on both days. Beautiful, lovely time. The palms, the symbols of victory, which often, not always, but often people will hold also in their coffins when they are departing this earthly life. The palms as a symbol of victory of life over death. So
okay.
So we, in Holy Week, literally walk with the Lord. Every day is a part of this week that he is also going through, from the sort of outward height of his ministry on Palm Sunday when he's welcomed into Jerusalem as King and God, all the way to his betrayal, to his crucifixion and death.
Bridegroom Matins.
Bridegroom
Monday,
Matins.
Tuesday and Wednesday?
Yes. So they are... in our parish, we have the practice of not doing the Matins on Sunday evening because everybody is totally wiped out after the big Palm Sunday weekend.
We're not monks, Father.
That's right. So we do have pre-sanctified the first 3 days of Holy Week. That's standard. And Monday, that set of services is a little longer because we do the Bridegroom Matins in the morning before the... But in any case, it's not nearly as long as...
Just the morning?
On Monday. Okay. The other times it's in the evenings, okay. But we have to get that one from Sunday in, and we do it in the morning on Monday. On that week, there's a practice in the church to read the entire Gospels up to about the midpoint of the John Gospel. But it's
In 1 week?
Yes, it's very hard. I remember when I was a young priest...
You should ask for some help for that.
I agree. So I remember when I was assigned to do that one day, go through the cycle of one day when I was a young a student in seminary, and it was a great experience. But that was a lot of gospel reading.
You had to read aloud.
Yep, aloud, and it was long, like hour at a time. Mm-hmm. And so it's a lot. What the bishop has blessed us to do in parishes in the diocese is to rotate the Gospels. So this year we're on Luke. Mm. And what we do is we break it up over the second half of Great Lent at the pre-sanctified liturgies. So now, beginning with the last Wednesday, the 15th of March, at the 3rd, 6th, and 9th hours, we read one chapter of Luke. And we do that now through the rest of Great Lent. And that way we read all of Luke. All right, next year we'll do John, and so on and so forth. And that way in the parish, we kind of keep the flavor of this, but we don't have this. It's just not practical. People are not going to stand for an hour at a time to listen to the gospel, as beautiful and as meaningful as it is. And so this is, I think, a nice way to do that. So we break it up over the one of the four gospels over the course of Great Lent.
Okay.
Yep, and so we have the beautiful Bridegroom Matins, which are called that because of the ex apostolarian, which is a word I try to use every day if I can. The ex apostolarian at Matins.
If anybody can do it, Father, it's you.
The ex apostolarian at Matins is about "Behold, the Bridegroom cometh at midnight," and it's one of those hymns of the church, which has been many of the church hymnographers have written different music for it. So it's there's a lot of very different and beautiful arrangements for this this piece. So anyway, it's a very nice Matins. So each evening we'll have that Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday morning, pre-sanctified. Then Thursday morning.
Wednesday evening, what happens?
Wednesday evening actually is another Bridegroom Matins. You sing that ex apostolarian again, so I guess we call it that. Then Thursday, this is the institution of the Mystical Supper.
That's the latest liturgy.
This is, let's see, what is the latest one of the year? I think this is the latest one of the year. It's a very late one.
Because it's the institution of the
Mystical Supper. It is, and it's one of those where...
Is this the one where you can have breakfast and then...
We don't serve it that late right now. It used to be when Father Michael was healthier and he was serving, he would begin the service around 2. Mm-hmm. And that was really nice. But then I would come, and I would lead the next service a few hours later, the reading of the 12 Gospels. But since he's been ill and hasn't been able to do that, we've moved it a little bit earlier. So we serve it at 10 o'clock instead of 8 o'clock, as we usually would on a weekday. But this is a late one. It's one of the very late ones, like Holy Saturday. It's a very late service. It was kind of almost a beginning of an online vigil, which would end with those 12 Gospel service. So the morning institution of the Mystical Supper, beautiful service, a lot of Old Testament readings at the Vesperal Divine Liturgy. And then that evening, the Matins for Holy Friday, which is the what we often
the 12
call the
Gospels.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, and a few years ago, we had kind of had the 12 tornadoes, but God willing, we won't have that again. That was a kind of a crazy day, but we got through it with some excitement, but we got through it.
Okay.
Then Friday.
No liturgy.
No liturgy. Yes, this is one of those, this is the most sort of somber, I guess, day you would say of the year. There's no liturgy. The fast is strict. No meal is taken until after the Vespers is completed. And that's usually something very light. So we begin, the way we do it in our parish is we, at 9 o'clock in the morning, we have royal hours. Now this is an interesting service. The content of the Gospels, which is read at this service, is the same themes that were covered at the 12 Gospels earlier, the day before, in the evening. And so it's perfectly good to come to both.
What are those themes?
Well, we're talking about the Lord's betrayal, the Lord's trial, mocking, so on and so forth, crucifixion, death. And the same themes are covered at the royal hours. Now, for some folks, it's not practical to come to that evening service. Mm-hmm. It's long and it's dark when you go home. Maybe people can't drive in the dark. Royal hours would be a great sort of substitute for that.
Are there gospel readings?
There are. At each of the four hours are read. They're read to include an Old Testament reading, a New Testament reading, and a gospel reading. And those gospel readings are relatively lengthy, as they were the evening before. They're not the same ones, but they cover the same themes. And so if you can't come to the Matins, to the 12 Gospel service on Thursday evening, you might seriously think about coming on Friday morning. It's a beautiful little service. It's very quiet. It's very reflective. It's, you know, not dark in the church because there's sunlight, but there's no lights. It's just a really beautiful, quiet service that a lot of people don't get to experience. I guess we should take a step back too, and I know that several people have mentioned to me every year, we need people to understand the necessity, the beauty of that Thursday evening 12 Gospel service. It's such a beautiful service. It's so, the content is so important and beautiful and meaningful. And the choir works so hard to prepare themselves. I mean, there's a lot of really beautiful hymns. And, you know, we get a decent turnout, but not as much as we should. You know, people should be there. If you can't be there on Friday morning at the Royal Hours. After the Royal Hours, we kind of clear out the middle of the church where the crucifixion has been, and we set up the tomb, right, in preparation for the Vesper service where the Plashenitsa is brought out, and it's the first opportunity for people to venerate the burial shroud of the Lord. After that, there's a light meal. Then we come back in the evening, and we have Matins already for Holy Saturday. This is the burial service of the Lord. This is where we process around the church with the Plashenitsa. Another wonderful.
You want
service.
To give a short definition of the Plashenitsa for?
Yes. This is the icon of the Lord laying in the tomb. Mm-hmm. So if you come to the church on Holy Friday or Saturday or even Pascha.
After lunchtime,
mm-hmm, you will find in the middle of the church this burial shroud icon of
what do the
Lord.
Greeks call it?
Epitaphion. Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And it's an icon which is painted on a very long board. It's probably must be close to 4 feet, and there we have the Lord laying in the tomb. So this is sort of the center point of the services while it's in the midst of the church. In fact, the Friday evening service, the service begins in front of the Plashenitsa. It ends there. The dismissal is given there. On Holy Saturday, for Divine Liturgy in the morning, communion is taken in front of the Plashenitsa, not up in the front of the church as usual. So it's really the center of the church's life for those, let's say, 48 hours.
When is the cross procession with the procession.
So. It's towards the end of the service on Friday evening. Mm-hmm. Yes, and then this is where we will go around the church, and this is the sort of descent into hell of the Lord, and is also called the burial service. It's a beautiful, beautiful service.
And then it goes to the altar?
That's right before the Paschal Matins begins. So it stays after we go around the church. It stays in the middle of the church.
And it's their Saturday.
It's their Saturday. Yeah. It's their all-day Saturday. And in some parishes, the church is open all day Saturday. People can come. I don't know if we're going to be able to do that. We're going to try. But it's best to be there when the services are there. Then you know for sure that you're going to have the opportunity to venerate it. Yeah, it's a... Something very beautiful. And we're really blessed in our parish to have the Plashenitsa that we have. Okay. It's a really unique
It's a collector's
piece.
Item.
It really is. And actually, probably sometime soon we should stop using it and just, you know, like, preserve it.
Right.
It's from a White Army regimental church. So it was... in the Russian Imperial Army, each regiment had its own priest and deacon and choir singer, and they would serve the service.
Just one singer?
Yep, just one singer. I mean, if the soldiers could sing, they were allowed right. to, but there was a conductor. And this burial shroud that we have is from one of those regiments. So the black velvet it's a very beautiful. Beautiful thing, and we're very blessed to have it. But at some point here soon, we're probably going to have to replace it just so that it doesn't fall apart. Mm-hmm. But a very beautiful, and we try to, of course, take very good care of it.
We could put it in a case in the new church somewhere.
Yes, I think maybe we'll have to do something like that. And
could it go like vertically? Could
yes,
it go on the
wall? And you often see that. You often see that the as they are retired, if they have a special sort of meaning, a special case will be made, and even people can light candles there. I mean, it's a very beautiful icon, very well done. So, yeah. Great. So that's we've gotten through. I think Holy Saturday.
Is it Pascha yet?
Almost. We're almost there. Holy Saturday is one of those really interesting ones too, because you know this is one of those liturgies that should be very late. In our parish, we do it early, and most people do because they want. The folks want to go home, they want to get ready for Pascha, they want to have a rest.
That's when we get the wine, too.
Yes, wine and bread, very interesting practice, but that's because it was such a late service. It was done very, very late, maybe started at 4 p.m. And so by the time it
We're talking ancient church.
Yes. By the time it ended, then they would bless the bread and the wine to strengthen people for the Paschal Vigil, and then they'd begin to read the Acts of the Apostles. Right, so we don't follow that exact structure. We do the service early in the morning, then there's a big break, and we start reading the Acts of the Apostles at 10 o'clock. Now, this is something that folks should be aware of. If you speak a language that is not English or Russian, consider...
Like French.
French, Latin, we've done Greek.
Somali.
Have we had Somali before? I don't remember. But we've had Georgian, of course, mm-hmm. Armenian... Uzbek, surprisingly oh, yeah. often, oh, yeah. actually. And in any case, if you speak a language which a Turkmen we had also last year, I think we did 14 last year, so we want to try to do more. So if you have a language, please talk to Ken Dahl, who's our head reader. He'll be soon advertising this to the whole parish, but it's really an important part of our Paschal service to show that Christianity is the faith for everyone. For absolutely everyone, and this is why the tradition of reading in many languages has grown up around this.
And American is not a language.
Did I say American?
No.
Oh, good.
I just wanted to
okay.
throw that
out. No, I'm glad. I think as an English teacher, it's important that you make that very clear. And, you know, I've got an English minor, and my parents want me to, you know, use that as often as I can. Now we're at Pascha.
Finally.
Yes.
Hasn't it been 7 weeks or so?
Yeah, something like that.
That
yes.
we fasted.
Yes.
And waited.
Yes. And
it was worth the wait.
It was worth the wait. It, you know, and it's always, you know, what we put into Great Lent always comes back to us at Pascha.
It's a good investment.
It's a very good investment. You get the best return on your investment that you can. We have a little service at 11:15. It's called the Paschal Midnight Hours, and we sing for the last time the Canon of Holy Saturday. it's interesting because both on Friday evening at the that service and here right before Pascha, the priest reads in front of the Plashtunitsa this canon of Holy Saturday. And you know, this is a really important canon for the priests because this is the canon that's read at their funerals. And they know that. This is not a secret. And you can't help but kind of reflect on that as you're reading that canon and listening to the really beautiful hymnography that as the choir is singing. So right at the end of that service, then the Plashtunitsa is brought into the altar, is placed on the altar table, and will stay there until the Feast of the Ascension. Mm-hmm. So for 40 days, Divine Liturgy is served on the Plashtunitsa in the altar, which looks a lot like, still the Antimens is opened on top of it, but it's sort of, it stays there on the altar, and we serve Divine Liturgy on it for the entire time of the, until Ascension.
Which is when we can say the holy...
During the time when we say Christ is risen.
Well, no, the Holy Spirit prayer. Is that's when it comes back?
Oh, no, it's 10 days before that. So for 40 days after Pascha, the Plashtunitsa stays on the altar until Ascension. And then we've got 10 days, and then we have the Pentecost. Yep, absolutely.
Do that till Pentecost. Yep, yeah. That makes sense. Right, okay, so we got the Pascha,
mm-hmm.
and... That's good.
Yep, we want to get there. Want to talk about Bright Week a little bit?
Absolutely, be done? Father.
Okay, we'll be quick.
That's the White Week on the calendar.
That's right. There is no fasting that week at all. And in fact, even in the strictest skeets in places like Valam, where the monks would fast according to Lenten rules the entire year, on that week, they would have eggs. The fast has to be broken. And, you know, if only we were quite so moderate in our breaking of the fast, but that's something that we'll talk about hopefully later. In any case, during Bright Week, there's a very interesting prohibition, and that prohibition is marriages. Huh. Isn't that interesting? To me, that's very interesting.
Well,
that's
we weren't getting married during the fast.
Right, that's right, and that makes sense. You think fasting, it's not marriage time, but now it's a celebration. We should be, like, you know, we get married, we celebrate. And marriage is a great celebration, but what's interesting is that we should be serving, according to the Typikon, Divine Liturgy every single day, and every evening, celebrating in the church. And then, so where do you fit in the wedding? There's no room for it. So there are two interesting times of prohibition of weddings. The Lenten times make perfect sense, but two very celebratory times between Nativity and Theophany and during Bright Week. So it's so interesting. So we're celebrating, ideally serving liturgy every day. We're not going to quite get it this year in our parish. We'll have four divine liturgies. Pascha itself, Bright Monday, which is a really good time to come if you can't come to Pascha because you can't drive then or you have little kids. We're going to do Thursday this year. And then Saturday, which is the children's liturgy. And this is always a really nice one because the kids sing, the kids do everything in the church, and then we have, after each liturgy, we have a procession with the artos, the blessed bread from the Paschal service. But on Saturday, we have the kids do everything there. And it's really, really a beautiful opportunity, including the procession is led by the kids. They have the banners, the cross, the icons, everything. And I think it's really nice. You know, the kids should be part of the family always, but it's sometimes nice to do something a little special, and so this is a really special day, the Bright Saturday. And then, well, that's Bright Week, and then on the vigil of Saturday night of Bright Week, then the doors are closed at the during the Vespers service at Lord, I Have Cried. They've remained open all during the Bright Week. The doors to the altar have remained open. And then the next day, Thomas Sunday, it's our practice in the West to go to the cemeteries and greet our departed relatives and friends with the Paschal.
In the West?
Yes. The real day when you would do this is 2 days later on a feast called Radonitsa. And this is the time when folks would do that. But, you know, we don't have this agrarian society when we kind of say, okay, we'll milk the cows and we'll go to church. You know, you have to go to work and so on and so forth. So it kind of shifted to be on the Thomas Sunday, which is really
nice. It's
nice
that the church can be accommodating.
Yeah, we try to be flexible. Yeah. You know, where we can, we try to be flexible. So We go to the cemeteries and we greet everyone there who's been resting and waiting for the general resurrection with the resurrection of the Lord. And we bring the Paschal eggs and we sing the Paschal hymns. It's just a beautiful, beautiful tradition. And we hope that we'll get a lot of people to come with us.
Speaking of eggs, when will the parish egg hunt take place? Is it scheduled yet?
It isn't. Right now, the only thing that's absolutely locked in after Pascha is the Brotherhood's...
The Brotherhood, yes.
You know, on the Feast of the Barbarian.
Why don't you let a former brother head talk about
yes,
that?
You're yes. The head brother, John. Tell us about
it. No, I'm not.
Oh, you were.
I were.
Right,
I
you were. You were. So you're retired.
Yeah.
But that's all right. It's, you know, retirement is important.
Yeah. Although I could be like Grover Cleveland and have
I think we should call you Emeritus.
Okay.
Yeah, Emeritus Head Brother.
Can I get a business card?
Of course, absolutely.
Great.
So tell the folks about the practice that the brothers have on the
Well,
on
folks, the this is the second Sunday, not Thomas Sunday, the second Sunday after Pascha, and it's when we celebrate the Holy Myrrh Bearers who came to the tomb, the first to show up, right?
Yep.
And we like to do something nice for our ladies in the church, and that is make the meal. And so the brothers cook, the brothers serve, the brothers wash and clean up. So if you're a brother, you don't want to miss it because we need your help. And if you're a non-brother, you also want to show up because it means you don't have to do as much that day.
It's really nice. It's a great tradition. I think it's really super. I mean, we
is
do
that just our tradition, or
you know, it's a pretty widespread tradition. I think.
I thought we made that up. I thought we.
I don't think we made it up. I just, you know, flagrantly
but
stole
we,
that
we,
from somewhere
okay,
else.
Okay, but we definitely observe it.
We observe it, and I think we've kind of taken it to a new level. I mean, you know, sometimes.
Well, with
be...
Carl Meyer's beer can or the grilled chicken. That,
yes.
Yep, that's definitely.
That I mean, there's a lot of good
it's
food.
It's hard
there.
To top.
It is. There's a lot of good food there, and I think it's really fun for the men too. I mean, you know, it's a nice bonding experience, and so that's really nice. I like that a lot, and I think it's a lot of fun, and I hope folks will join us for that. That's the last Sunday in April.
All right. Well, we got through what we wanted to. And so I thank you.
Thank you, John.
I thank our producer, Josh. And I thank you, dear viewers and loyal supporters of the Vladcast program. Like we said, we'll be seeing you much more often because we have a shooting schedule and a studio and a green room. And all that stuff. Okay.
Yep.
So don't miss it. And come to church. Signing off. See you next time. Bye.